We appreciate you very much. We're also very thankful for Brother Riley Nelson and his great work. I've known Riley ever since I started at the Memphis School of Preaching. He has always been a great presence at the lectureship from year to year. I began the Memphis School of Preaching 20 years ago this year, and have known Riley off and on since that time, and it's such a great opportunity to be here with you and to be part of this Southeast Georgia lectureship. I'll tell you what, I'm on my fifth year working in Georgia, and this has been an excellent work. I think that the state of Georgia is primed and ready to grow like crazy. I think that some people that have told me, that have studied the situation, have told me recently that they think that the church is growing faster in the state of Georgia, perhaps than anywhere else in the United States. And I think that's great. And we need to do our part in order to keep that trend going. And so it's great to be a part of this lectureship. As I said, my topic today comes from Hebrews chapter 2. But if you'll indulge me for just a minute or two, I want to give you a little bit of introduction to the entire book of Hebrews, because I think that will help you out through the rest of this day and throughout the rest of this lectureship. If you don't learn anything else from my sermon this morning, I want you to take this away from it. The book of Hebrews is a book about Jesus Christ. Hebrews presents Jesus Christ as preeminent. And if we don't understand that fact, then we're never really going to learn Hebrews like God wants us to. Jesus is superior in every way to all of the servants that were sent by God before he came. And you can really outline the book of Hebrews by going through and looking at the emphasis of the things that Jesus is better than. For instance, chapters 1 and 2, we find that Jesus is better than the angels. In chapters 3 and the first part of chapter 4, you find the Hebrews writer emphasizing the idea that Jesus is greater than Moses. You know, those people to whom this book was written really revered Moses as the great lawgiver of God. But the Hebrews writer says Jesus is greater than Moses. We find in the latter part of chapter 4 down through chapter 7 that Jesus' high priesthood is superior to the Levitical high priesthood under that Old Testament system. And in chapters 7 and 8, that the new covenant that Jesus brought is superior to the old covenant under the law of Moses. We also find that the sacrifice that Jesus made is better than all of the animal sacrifices under the patriarchy or the law of Moses, according to chapters 9 and chapter 10. The blessings of Christianity are superior to the blessings that they enjoyed in Judaism, chapter 11 emphasizes. And then 12 and 13 shows us that we have a better reason to stay faithful even than they had under that Old Testament system. And so over and over and over in the book of Hebrews, what we find is Jesus is held up on a pedestal as better than all that came before. You know, obedience to Jesus was in those days and is today the only path to salvation. It's the only way we can get to heaven. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. And that's true. That was true in the days when Hebrews was written, and it continues to be true today. You know, there's a lot of talk about who wrote the book of Hebrews. Well, I'll tell you, you can be sure of the author of Hebrews because it is God. There is not a single thought, idea, or precept that you will read in the book of Hebrews that did not originate in the divine mind of God. And to argue over the human penman is sort of like arguing with your wife about what brand the pen was that you signed your marriage certificate with. It really doesn't matter who wrote it, who the human penman is. I think when you look at all the evidence, you might find, like I have, that the likely author, a human penman at least, is the Apostle Paul. he certainly would fit all the requirements of somebody who would write a letter like the book of Hebrews. Number one, he was certainly an expert in the Old Testament law. Number two, you find when you study the book of Hebrews that whoever the human penman was a master of the Greek language. But most importantly, the human penman of the book of Hebrews was inspired by the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
That's how we know where it came from. That's how we know to follow it. And so, if it is not the Apostle Paul, then there certainly is no other indication of who might have been the human penman, and it's really not worth arguing over anyway. And so, who then was the book of Hebrews written to? Well, it was written to Hebrew Christians. Christians who had served under the law of Moses, and then later when they understood and heard the gospel and obeyed it, they became New Testament Christians. Now, in the course of living their Christian life, though, they came under tremendous persecution from their families, their employers, people in their social circles. You know, I don't think, at least in this country, we can really appreciate the kind of pressure that people can put on you because of what your religious preferences really are. You know, in some other places, I'm sure Brother John Grubb has seen this, and I have heard stories of my friends, for instance, in India, tell about widow women who came out of Buddhism or Hinduism and obeyed the gospel and were kicked out of their homes by their own families. My friend in India told me about little old widow women who literally lived under the porch of the homes that they were kicked out of just to keep the rain off of them. We don't really understand what it's like to face that kind of persecution in this country. That's the kind of things that some of these people were facing. They were facing tremendous persecution. And so they needed encouragement. They needed to be taught to stay faithful no matter what they faced in this life. And friends, I don't know about you, but I think that's an important message today as well. You know, we might not face the same kind of persecution that they faced, but we face the same kind of punishment if we drift away from God than what they faced. And so we need to be encouraged to stay faithful to Jesus Christ as well. Most likely, this book was written to those Hebrew Christians in and around the area of Palestine. And probably, when you look at the internal evidence, it was written somewhere not too far away from when the destruction of Jerusalem would take place. And so before the destruction of Jerusalem, and if it is the case that it was written by the Apostle Paul, then it was probably very near the end of his life here on this side of eternity. The assignment that was given to me to cover in this particular lesson was Hebrews chapter 2, verse number 1. Hebrews chapter 2, verse number 1, what we find there is a warning to these Hebrew Christians in the first century. But it is one that is worthy of our study today, as we'll find out. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse number 1 says, "Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip." You know, as I studied this passage, I found out that it is made up of just 10 words in the original Greek language. Just 10 words, and yet it is such a powerful message for us today. With the time we have left, I want to study this particular passage, word by word and phrase by phrase. And then, as we have time left over at the end, if we do, I want to give you some practical application that will keep us drifting away from God, as this passage commands. Number one, let's talk about the word therefore. Therefore. This is a word that was used by the inspired writers to give the foundation of the argument that they were about to make. When you find the word therefore, what you're going to see is basically the idea of because of all of these things that were just written, here's why I'm making the statement that I'm about to make. And so this therefore is very important in our study. Because of the things written in chapter 1, he can give this he can give this warning that begins chapter 2. And there is no firmer foundation that could be laid as the basis of this warning than the statements that were made about Jesus Christ in chapter 1. When you go back and study chapter 1, you will find that Jesus Christ is held up as, first of all, the heir of all things. It's also said that he made the worlds, that is, the entire physical universe was spoken to existence by Jesus himself. The Bible says that Jesus is the express image of God, and that he upholds all things by the word of his power. It says that he by himself purged our sins through his own actions. He is the one that sits at the right hand of the throne of the Father, and the angels worship Jesus Christ. Also, chapter 1 tells us that Jesus is the one that holds the scepter of righteousness forever and possesses the eternal nature of God. Now, if you deny any or all of those things, do you know what you're doing? You're denying the divinity of Jesus Christ. You're denying his Godhood. And that reminds me of 1 John chapter 2 and verse number 22, which says, "Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son." And so this entire warning that he's about to give here, the rest of this verse, is predicated upon the foundation that Jesus Christ is God. And to deny that endangers our souls in the most precarious way. So therefore, everything that we're going to study from this point forward is based upon the superior nature of Jesus Christ and his Godhood. Number two, the second word, therefore we. Now that's a powerful little word, isn't it? That means that this passage is a warning for Christians. Remember, the Hebrews writer was writing to people that were Christians. Yes, he was writing, of course, to those people in the first century, but it's also been preserved for you and me. And so the message that they receive is important for us today as well. You and I are ones that need to heed this warning. You know, the very fact that we have a warning here, by the way, destroys the old false doctrine of once saved, always saved, doesn't it? If it were true that once you became a Christian, nothing else you did mattered because you were going to be saved no matter what, why would the Bible record all these warnings? Not just this one, but every one that we have sprinkled throughout the New Testament. The truth of the matter is we do have to be concerned about what we do and what we don't do as children of God, because our souls are on the line. You know, God wouldn't warn us against an impossibility, would he? He warns us about things that could happen. He warns us about things that are likely to happen if we take certain paths. And so we've got to be very, very careful. And so as we study this entire book, I want you to know that this was written to us. I have to address this warning to my own life just as you have to address it to yours. Therefore, we ought. The next word, ought, is very important as well. The Greek word from which this English word is translated is found 106 times in the Textus Receptus from which the King James is translated. And 58 of those times, this same word is translated must. It carries the idea of doing that which is right and proper. Something that is necessary based on the righteousness of God. Now, the very fact that this word is in the Bible demonstrates to us that according to God, there are some things that are objectively right. In other words, God has given us a standard that we can follow. We're not out there just stumbling around in the dark trying to figure out ourselves the difference between what is right and what is wrong, because God has told us already. He has given us His Word. You know, when God says that something is right, then that necessarily implies that there are some things that are wrong too. The Bible is a book of right and wrong. It's not a big gray area where we can go and dance around and do anything we want to and justify it in our minds. It's a book that tells us the difference between right and wrong. Atheism denies objective right and wrong. But I'll tell you something. If I have to choose between atheism and God, I'm choosing God every time. I'm choosing His Word because I know that God's Word teaches that some things are right. Psalm 119 and verse number 160 says, Thy word is true from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever. Psalm 119 and verse 172 says, My tongue shall speak of thy word, for all thy commandments are righteousness. When you have time, study the whole 119th Psalm. I don't have time to read every passage in that great psalm that upholds the Word of God as that which is right. You know, when Jesus was talking to His disciples in John 17:17, He said, Sanctify them through thy word is truth. God's Word is truth. You can count on that. You can take it to the bank. And we learn that from that little word, ought. Therefore, we ought. What does it say next? Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed. To give the more earnest heed is just two words in the Greek. But those two words and the English phrase that is translated by those two words demonstrate our responsibility. You know, God has always upheld His end of the bargain. But these people out there in the religious world that teach that God does everything, They don't really seem to understand the way that God's Word has revealed the history of mankind to us. The truth of the matter is, God has always required things of men. Now, God always does His part, but the problem is, man doesn't always do his. This passage shows us that there is something that we must do in order to be pleasing to God. The first of these two Greek words here is an adverb. Maybe you were like me in English. That was my weakest subject, even through preaching school. They told us when I was in preaching school that they taught English as a second language because most of us spoke Southern, and that's probably true. But an adverb tells you how a thing is done. And this Greek word from which is translated this phrase, the more earnest heed, this Greek word means more exceedingly or more abundantly. Some dictionaries give the word superabundantly. That's what this word means. It's used a number of times in the Scriptures. In one place is Mark chapter 15, verse number 14. Mark chapter 15 is where Pilate was trying in his feeble way to defend Jesus, and the crowd was crying out, Crucify Him. And Pilate said in verse number 15, Why? What evil thing hath He done? And the Bible says that they cried out more exceedingly, Crucify Him. That's this word here. Something that where you redouble your efforts over and over again. Superabundantly. This is also the same word found in Galatians 1 and verse number 14, where Paul says that he had profited in the Jews' religion above many, my equals in mine own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. You know how exceedingly zealous he was? So zealous that he persecuted Christians even to the point of death. That's how superabundantly he thought of his tradition, the Jewish traditions. And so this word then modifies the idea of giving heed. This Greek word translated heed here literally means to bring to. As if you were bringing a ship to the shore to draw it in, to draw it closer. And figuratively here, it means to draw this information to your mind. It means to turn the mind to, or to give attention to. God's instruction here is for His people to pay super abundant attention to these things that He's discussing. To bring them to our minds more and more and more. That's what God wants of us. That reminds me, for instance, of 2 Timothy 2 and verse number 15 that says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." What does God want you to do? He wants you to study. That's your part. To study and learn and put those things into practice. Psalm 119 and verse number 11, the psalmist said, "Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee." How do you hide the word of God in your heart? You give it super abundant attention. That's how. By studying it diligently. I'm reminded of Psalm 1, 1 and 2. It says, "Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful." Why? "But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night." That's the kind of attitude that he's talking about here in Hebrews chapter 2, verse number 1. The kind of attitude that says, "I'm going to meditate in the Word of God day and night. I'm going to study it super abundantly." Why? Because that's the kind of love I have for God. That's the kind of concern I have for my soul. I want to know more and more and more about the Word of God. The next phrase that we're going to talk about is the phrase, "to the things which we have heard." It is amazing to me that this phrase translates a single Greek word in the original. And that original word literally means "the things which we have gotten by hearing." You know, it sounds so passive to talk about the things that we've heard. Well, you know, you probably heard things driving into this church building today. You had the radio on in your car, you probably heard some songs or some people talking. Or if you had your windows down, you might have heard some people mowing grass or some birds chirping. That's awful passive, though, isn't it? This is talking about something that we have gotten by hearing, something that we have been actively involved in. Here it implies not just auditory perception. It implies the idea of understanding, comprehending these things. And I think that certainly this very phrase refers back to Hebrews chapter 1 and verse number 2. Where it says, "Hath in these last days spoken unto us by His Son." You see, the things that we have gotten by hearing came from Jesus Christ. Jesus speaks today through His Son, and His Son speaks through His Word. That's the way that it works. And so these are things that we have gotten. You know, we don't learn the gospel passively, do we? The truth of the matter is, we don't become Christians by accident. We don't accidentally stumble into heaven. That's not the way it works. It's something that you have to set your mind to. It's something that you have to be actively engaged in if you want to make it to heaven. And so these things that he's talking about here are things that we have gotten from hearing Jesus and studying His Word. The things that we have dug out, maybe with help. I'm thankful I have people to help me. I'm kind of like that Ethiopian eunuch sometimes. You remember when the servant of God ran up and joined himself in that chariot and said, "Understandest thou what thou readest?" And he said, "How can I except some man should guide me?" There's been a lot of times in my life where I need somebody to help me understand the Word of God. That's okay. Nothing wrong with that. Just make sure that the decisions that we make are based on ultimately on the standard that God has given. You know, these things which we have gotten by hearing came from Jesus Christ. And so I think it's a really good question to ask. These things that we've gotten from Jesus, how have they changed us? How has it made you different now that you've obeyed the gospel? You know, I know for some of you, maybe in this room, you have to go back a ways to think about when you were baptized. Others, Probably not so long. But you know, the truth of the matter is the gospel changes a person from the inside out. It's the most powerful force for change that there is on this side of eternity. And it will change you into something that you didn't think you could be. It will make you do things you didn't know you could do. That's the kind of powerful change you can find in the Scriptures. If this be written by the Apostle Paul, don't you know that he could look back in his life and see the tremendous changes that took place in his life because of the gospel? From one who was trying to destroy Christianity 180 degrees to now a person who is planting churches all over the known world and is so dedicated to his service to Jesus Christ, that nothing, literally nothing in this world could deter him from doing the work that God wanted him to do. You could beat him. You could shipwreck him. You could chain him to soldiers. None of that mattered. He was going to do what God wanted him to do. How has Jesus' doctrine changed you? You know, so many things we could study about here. We could talk about Jesus' teaching about his self-sacrifice for the sins of mankind. We could talk about his mission to seek and save that which was lost. We could talk about his instruction to the church to go out and to preach the gospel and carry out the Great Commission to save those that were lost. So many things we could pause right here and talk about the doctrine of Jesus Christ that we have gotten by hearing. But the question is, how have you let it change you? The next word that we find in the Greek here is a single word translated, lest at any time. This is called a prohibitive conjunction. And what it means is that we're not to allow this to happen at any time. This clearly teaches the time that Christians can falter. And that time is any time. If they could falter because of persecution, we can falter because of persecution. If they could give in to temptation and go back the way that they were before, so can we. We have to keep our guard up at all times. 1 Corinthians 10 and verse number 12, the Bible says, wherefore to him that thinketh he standeth, take heed, lest he fall. You know, the time that the devil has got you the strongest is when you think you're at your strongest. That's when he's got you, because that's when you're likely to fall. 1 Peter 5 and verse number 8 says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. I think the idea there is that when and if we drop our guard, that's when the devil pounces. That's when he's going to take us down. 1 Corinthians 16 and verse number 13 says, watch ye. Literally, that means be on guard. Stand fast in the faith. Quit ye like men. Be strong. Why? Why does Christianity take all that strength? It's because the devil is very real. He's very vicious. He's very cruel. What was happening to those Hebrew Christians to whom this letter was originally written was a triumph for Satan. When you turn your back on Jesus, when you go back into the old way of life, whatever that was, maybe it was hedonism, maybe it was denominationalism, whatever it is that we could turn back to, it's not worth it. And if we go back to it, the devil wins. And so be on guard. Why? Because we could stumble at any time if we drop our guards. And then finally, the phrase, we should let them slip. Again, a single word in the Greek. Very interesting word. This word, translated, we should let them slip, literally means to glide by. To glide by. Young's literal translation concludes this passage that, by saying, we may glide aside. Other versions, like the New King James and the ESV, warned us that we could drift away. Drifting is a nautical term. One of the first jobs I ever had when I got out of high school was the job of assistant dock master at the Pensacola Yacht Club. Well, doesn't that sound fancy? Really, that means I just came in early in the morning and made sure all the boats were tied up. You know, all those boats that were docked out there, every one of them was docked in what they call a slip. I think that's interesting. It's called a slip, but when you tie it up,